Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is September 11, 2016. This is the 15th anniversary of the bombing of the World Trade Center. Take a few moments to give silent thanks for our country and the people that lost their lives.
Keep us in union with all your saints and bring us with him to the joyful feast of heaven, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We now begin our worship with Lift High the Cross, hymn number 660, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 660, Lift High the Cross.
This is an appropriate hymn for today, Lift High the Cross, as we remember the cross beams of 9/11, when the World Trade Towers were felled. And we're singing this partially in honor of 9/11. It was written by George W. Kitchen, 1827, 1912. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.
Let us pray. O God, overflowing with mercy and compassion, you lead back to yourself all those who go astray. Preserve your people in your loving care, that we may reject whatever is contrary to you, and may follow all things that sustain our life in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated as we listen to the reading of the Gospel.
Diane Myers is doing the readings today.
The first reading is from Exodus, the 32nd chapter. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf, and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt.' The Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them. And in you I will make a great nation.' But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, 'O Lord, why does your wrath burn high against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, "It is with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth"? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, "I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever." And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. The word of the Lord.
Becky Demetrov will sing the song.
For me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason I received mercy, for that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The Lord.
Mr. Pollock will send us.
Singing the gospel acclamation, our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. He is now at the pulpit. He'll be reading the gospel. The theme today is God's mercy. God's mercy. And also we're honoring the victims of 9/11.
Children's church, where they will have an opening and a lesson, and
Now I ask that you give your attention to our choir for the special message for today.
Our choir is singing special music under the direction of Vicki Perks.
According to St. Luke, and the question of more accurately say, since the fall. And our first parents were kicked out of paradise and civilizations began to develop. The question arose, what must I do to be saved? Every ancient civilization, no matter how primitive, no matter how advanced, had some form of religious life. They believed in some kind of supreme being, or beings, depending on the culture. And they developed a system in which people strive to try to earn that salvation. Of course, when the time was right, God sent His Son in the form of a baby into the world, and as that baby grew into a man, He then revealed to us through His teachings that we do nothing to earn our salvation, that we cannot do anything for our salvation, that it's all an act of God, that we are saved by grace through faith, apart from works of the law, that salvation is God's free gift to those who believe in His Son. So today, instead of looking at the question of what must I do to be saved, since we know what we must do, and that's believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, what we're going to examine is what must you do to become lost? Now that may seem like a strange question for a Christian congregation, but the reality is any one of us can become lost. The sad reality today is more people are leaving the church than entering the church. One denomination reports that they lose one member every 5 minutes and have been doing so for the past 10 years. Another denomination admits to losing 1 million members the past 10 years. Every church member is a potential loss. So what do we mean by this? In the parables today, the sheep, lost sheep, and the lost coin, in our gospel lesson, we see situations where both were saved or secure at one moment, and then they became lost. And the same can happen to us. What do you do to become lost? The first step is demonstrated by the wandering sheep. When a sheep wanders away from the herd, it will go so far until it's out of distance of the herd and the shepherd. And when it finds a comfortable looking spot, it will then just lay down and will begin bleeding and bleeding and bleeding. Not bleeding, B-L-E-D-I-G, but bleeding. Bad, bad, bad. All it does just keeps bad, bad, bad all day long. When the shepherd comes looking for it and discovers it, the sheep doesn't jump up on its feet and become excited that the shepherd is there with them. And instead, he stays laying on the ground. So the shepherd must literally bend down, pick the sheep up, throw it over his, around his neck and over his shoulders, and carry it back to the herd. A Christian can become lost by wandering off a little bit at a time from their involvement in the church. It begins first by stopping to attend the church's activities. Then it goes into no longer volunteering their time or talent or services at any of the church's ministries or serving on any boards or committees, any extra activity at all outside of worship. So then they're just attending on worship on Sundays, and then their attendance becomes sporadic. It becomes easier and easier each Sunday to go ahead and do something else that Sunday and say, well, I'm going to church the following Sunday. This then leads to a habit of only attending church Christmas and Easter, becoming what is commonly referred to as a Christian or a C&E Christian. Well, then that changes, and you start attending only one of the two major festivals. You either come on Christmas or you come on Easter, but not both. And then eventually, you drop out altogether. Many Christians do not intend to wander away from the church, but the demands on their time become more and more as a And unfortunately, and I've experienced this both as a child and as a pastor, when someone has been away from the church for a long time, for whatever reason, returns, instead of people rejoicing like the shepherd who finds his lost sheep, they're greeted with smart aleck comments like, "Well, I hope the roof doesn't fall in today since you decided to darken our door." "I hope the whole church doesn't collapse since you found a maiden." Or some other type of smart aleck comment, instead of welcoming them, rejoicing that they are back. Oftentimes, when you buy a ticket to go on a trip, go to a movie, go to a concert, go to an athletic event, it will have printed on it, "Not valid if detached." And so if for some reason you detach that part of the ticket from the rest of it, and you go to the concert or go to board the bus or train for the trip or plane, or you go to your athletic event or movie, you won't be allowed admission because you haven't violated a ticket. Well, when people detach themselves from Christ, then they lose out on the fellowship of the community of faith. When they detach themselves from the community of faith, they lose out on the opportunity to have an experience with the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, the Word and Sacrament, at worship. Now, I know people will tell you and tell me, when they go to the church, "Well, I can worship God anywhere. Or I can worship God on an altar." Well, when the last time you did that? "I can worship God out on the lake when I'm fishing." Really? When's the last time you did that? Or, "I can worship God in my own way." Maybe you can. But Jesus wants us to gather together as a community with Him. The whole idea is that Christianity is a community, a body of which Jesus Christ is the head. And so we do not want to be a detached ticket. We want to be together, be in Him, body of Christ always. We want to take His word seriously when He says, "Abide in me." So we want to abide in Him at all times. The other way that a church member can become lost is demonstrated by example of the parable of the lost coin. A woman has 10 silver coins. She loses one, and she begins to look for one. Now, while that coin is lost, it has no value, and it's out of circulation. It's hidden somewhere. And that's what happens when a Christian drifts away from the community of faith, taking themselves out of circulation, then they have no value to the community of faith because they're not sharing their spiritual gifts. They're not sharing their time, talent, and treasure. They're simply living off on their own like a hermit. And so it is easy to take yourself out of circulation, but there is also a danger. And before I continue, let me make it clear, which I hope I really don't have to, but oftentimes someone will misunderstand. When I'm talking about people not being in church, I'm not talking about those who are sick, I'm not talking about people recovering from surgery, I'm not talking about people who are in healthcare facilities, I'm talking about the normal Christian, healthy Christian, who could be in church on Sunday, but just decides that something else is more important, or he gets involved in something in which they find themselves entangled and hard to become free from. So we're not talking about the shut-ins, the sick, the recovering from surgery, and the like. So what we're talking about is when someone willfully takes himself out of circulation. In our gospel, the word translated as lost, when he says that not the shepherd had 100 sheep and he lost one of them, woman lost one coin, that word lost literally means to be out of the fellowship, to not be able to participate in worshiping God, to lose well-being and eternity, to become spiritually destitute. That is the danger of willfully taking yourself out of circulation in the community of faith. You become spiritually destitute. You lose out on the well-being of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and you even endanger your well-being in eternity. Taking yourself out of tribulation can cause you to miss out on a special encounter with God, our Lord Jesus Christ, that might have happened had you been there. One example of why people take themselves out of circulation is the beginning of our gospel lesson today, in which we read, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" How dare Jesus do such a terrible thing? But that is the attitude of some people in the church. They will leave a fellowship of believers because they do not like the new people or are becoming part of that fellowship. The word translated receives, or in your insert it was translated as welcomed, literally means to accept someone, accept them as they are, to admit them into a fellowship or into a group. It means to welcome them with open arms and to treat them as one of the family. And if in Jesus' day, to have table fellowship with someone meant that you accepted them or you would not eat them. So we have the habit of going to a restaurant, you all kinds of people, we don't know what they're like. Well, in the Middle East, you didn't do that. You did not sit down and break bread with anybody you did not know and you did not like. If you knew them and you didn't like them, you didn't eat with them. If you didn't know them, you didn't eat with them. You only hate those people you like. Well, here Jesus is being criticized because he's receiving sinners and eats with them. The Pharisees and the scribes could not stand the fact that Jesus was accepting the people that they daily looked down upon. They felt like Jesus should be like them. That Jesus should have the same prejudices and the same opinions that they had. What they had was right, and what Jesus was doing was wrong. And today, the church has its own brand of scribes and Pharisees in the form of members who make up their minds as to who should be part of the congregation and who shouldn't. And anyone who is different from them need not occupy a pew. And if you do occupy a pew, you better agree with them and think just like they do. But that is not what Jesus wants. How warm, and this, the question comes up, how warm and receptive are you to a new person, a stranger, or a visitor who enters worship? Do you greet them or do you ignore them? It's amazing how some church members seem to think that a person will just decide on their own to go to church and then after attending will automatically decide to join the church. That's not the way it is anymore. From the founding of this nation until the 80s, there was this underlying pressure to go to church. Basically, you had to go to church. It was a time period when almost all your shops in a community were locally owned. And a lot of times those shops were owned by someone who was very active in their church. If they found out you didn't go to church, they wouldn't hire you. They could do that back in those days. Or they would not give you that promotion you wanted. And so people would go to church even if they really didn't have a strong commitment to Jesus Christ, either for political gain because they were running for office or for financial gain in order to receive a promotion or to receive a job in a certain community. And when you turned on TV and the radio and went to the movies, they all reinforced and supported the values of the Christian faith and the values of which our nation was founded. It's not like that anymore. Today, people don't feel like they have to go to church. My generation, the baby boomers, too many of us, when we became parents, took the attitude that, well, my parents made me go to church, but I'm not going to make my children. I'll let them decide for themselves. But the funny thing is, you didn't let your child decide whether they were going to go to the doctor. You went through all those years of holding that child tightly in your arms while the doctor or the nurse gave you a shot. They were screaming and hollering, trying to get away from that shot. You made them go to the dentist, even when they didn't want to. You made them go to school, even when they didn't want to. So why would you let them wait until they were old enough to decide for the most important decision in their life? The decision between eternity and condemnation. But that's the attitude we grew up with. So now, as our children have become parents, many of them do not feel like they have to go to church because they didn't grow up in church. And so the church must reach out to the people and make them feel welcome and make them feel important, make them realize the importance of having a relationship with Jesus Christ, and making it clear that they really are interested in the person's well-being and not just wanting it as another body in the pew that can be counted on Sunday morning so that the attendance continues to rise instead of fall. You must make a person feel like they are part of the family. Last Sunday, after church was over, Gene and I, Matthew and Sarah and Victor, drove over to Indianapolis to spend the rest of Sunday and the first half of Monday with our middle son, Joel, in Indianapolis. And we arrived about 3:30, quarter four, and Joel had not been to church yet. Well, he had been to church, but he had been working in the children's church the whole time for all the morning services. So this church that he belongs to has a 5 o'clock and a 6 o'clock Sunday evening service. And so he asked if we wanted to go with him, and we said, of course, we'll go with him. As soon as we pulled up that parking lot, there was someone at the parking, beginning the entrance of the parking lot, directing us where to go, waving and saying welcome as soon as we pulled in. As we were directed to our parking spot, people said, waved and said hello as we got out there. People there to direct us to the front entrance. We walked in the front entrance. There was someone there greeting us, welcoming us to Hightown Church. There was this continuum. People greeting you and welcoming you and making you feel like they really were glad you were there and hoped you would be part of the worshiping experience in the future. Of course, I had to tell them, we didn't live there, we had our own church, so we only were there when we visited our son. But that is what the church has to do now. It's not like the founding of this nation up to the 70s when churches basically were filled with immigrants. Now, most Lutheran churches, especially big downtown Lutheran churches, were started because of immigrants. There were people who came from Germany, or Norway, or Sweden, or Denmark, or Finland, or Iceland, or Latvia, or Estonia, or parts of Lithuania, Hungary, Austria, Poland, and even Russia. And of course, after World War II, there were thousands of them that came over, escaping war-torn Europe, and looking to start a new life. Well, by the 80s, there were no more boats coming over from traditional Lutheran areas. There were no more Lutheran immigrants coming into this country unless they were from Africa or South America or Latin America or from Asia. They weren't as typical Germans, Scandinavians, and Baltic people. And it's not just with Lutherans, it's with most mainline denominations. We don't know how to attract non-Lutheran people to our worship. People have no loyalty today to a denomination. Some people will go through their life being three or four different churches, bouncing from Lutheran to Presbyterian to Episcopalian to Methodist to a mega church to something else. And so you have to make your church be warm and welcoming and make the people realize the importance of knowing Jesus Christ. Knowing who Jesus Christ is.
Christ is and why he's important in their life. If you don't, then they take themselves out of circulation. When I was serving one church, the topic of attracting new members came in. One of the members responded by saying, "Well, we advertise in the newspaper. Our service times are on the marquee outside. The doors are open, and anybody can just come in and come to church if wants to." Obviously, that was an attitude that was in dire need of change. And we changed that attitude, and we began to have more and more visitors, and we began to grow, and we began to double the size of the congregation. And then what did I hear? Comments such as, "Well, they're not really the kind of people we want. They're just not our type. Shouldn't bring them in." Such an attitude will kill a church faster than a natural disaster or a plague itself. As we know all too well, as demonstrated by our gospel lesson this morning, Jesus wants a diverse church. Jesus came to save all people, no matter who they might be, and he wants his church to be as diverse as possible. He wants his church to reflect or be a composite of the community in which it is located. It's true. You can't force people to go to church. You can't force people to join the church. But what you can do is legitimately glad when a stranger or visitor darkens the door. To truly be thankful to God that he has sent this person in our midst, and by their presence and service may be providing a badly needed spiritual gift that the congregation desperately needs. Yet, the arrival of new people sometimes makes traditional members or long-time members take themselves out of circulation. They'll become so angry, just like the Pharisees in our gospel lesson this morning. They'll become so angry over certain people becoming part of the community of faith that they no longer wish to be part of it, hurting themselves more than the congregation, and being very unchristlike in their actions toward the stranger, the visitor, or the new member. Other members may take themselves out of circulation due to a fundraising campaign, to build a new building, or to begin a new ministry, or to make some kind of renovation that they don't feel is necessary. They will often respond with, "It was good enough for us then, it should be good enough for them now." But unfortunately, that attitude doesn't cut it with the younger generations. The young people today with their children are not going to allow their child to sit in a Sunday school class that is the old coal bin from when the church was fueled by coal instead of electricity. If you don't have a classroom for their child, they will go to find a church that has a classroom feel like your child will be safe. As the old saying goes in the black church, if you keep on doing what you've already done, you'll keep on getting what you already got. Or, as a church growth person said at a seminar I attended, he said, if you're trying to do something and someone brings up about, well, they didn't do it that way in their day, or it was good enough in that day, ask them if the calendar still says 1956, or 1966, or 1976, or 1986. Because if it does, then what they're fighting for ain't going to work anymore. Our children are learning computers in kindergarten. Our grandchildren can already operate an iPhone or an Android phone. But society's changing. The world is shrinking through all of the modern technology. And so we cannot take the attitude, it was good enough for me when I was a child, it was good enough for my parents, and think that's going to convince a young family today to become part of the church family. Another motivation for people to take themselves out of circulation is a desire to cling on to the past and not accepting that oftentimes much needed change is necessary, so they take themselves out of circulation. Or another reason people take themselves out of circulation is because of too much emphasis on the past and not being open to new ideas of worship, form, or structure, or practice. I had a pastor tell me he supplied in a little church in Pennsylvania. And this was a couple years after the green hymn of the LBW had come out. And this little church only had about 30 or 40 people a Sunday, and he walked into the sanctuary and he was amazed to see the green hymnal sitting in a pew. But he thought this church being so small and so few people, I mean, the age group that they were, that they wouldn't have bothered with buying the LBW. So he walked over and picked it up. And of course, he was used to using the LBW. And when he picked it up and he opened it up, it wasn't the LBW. It wasn't even the old red service book and hymnal, which most of us remember. It was the black common service book and hymnal that I can vaguely remember when I was about 5 years old, usually in our church before the red book came out. What this congregation had done was, they liked the old common service so much and didn't want to change. Whenever the church issued a new hymnal, they just rebind their books to the color. That was the new hymnal. So I guess if that church is still in existence, now they're ready. Because of going to heal them. And so some people take themselves out of circulation because of a refusal to change anything or make anything. But whatever the reason, every church member faces the possibility of becoming lost. Every church member faces the possibility of wandering away or of taking themselves out of circulation. So what we must remember is that Jesus says following him is a commitment. It is a commitment that sometimes can cost us dear. He also tells us that once that commitment is made, he expects us to follow through, to not wander off, to not take ourselves out of circulation, and most of all, not to become lost. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing Whiter Than Snow, which is the hymn inserted in your book. Whiter Than Snow, the inserted hymn.
The gospel hymn is the insert in our bulletin today. It was written by a postal worker who immigrated from Ireland. His name is James Nicholson, and he wrote this hymn in 1872, Whiter Than Snow. Then it was adopted by the Dwight L. Moody Evangelism Group, and they sang it. It was written by James Nicholson, a postal worker from Washington, D.C. Thank you.
Let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Bill and Mary Nevis are the ushers. They will be receiving the altar today. Receiving the offering today. We're approaching the altar. This is September 11th, 2016, the 15th anniversary of 9/11, when our country was attacked. This is the 417th Sunday after Pentecost, September 11th, 2016. We welcome you to St. John's Lutheran Church. We're glad you're here today. This is the service of the Word. We will not receive Holy Communion today. We receive Holy Communion first and third Sunday of each month, festivals, and each Wednesday evening at 6:30. We have a midweek service at 6:30 p.m. Our morning services are at 8 a.m. and 10:30 a.m. in the sanctuary, Wittenberg in Columbia. Sunday school is at 9:15. We invite you to come to Sunday school for adults and children's classes and young people's classes. It starts at 9:15 every Sunday. We've now finished their summer time when we had the drive-in service. We've done our last drive-in service. We now have both services in the sanctuary. Watch our services on YouTube or Google. Put in St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, and you can watch our service. That's what you're watching right now, our service. We've had our great hymn today, Whiter Than Snow, written by a postal worker from Washington, D.C., who was inspired by the forgiveness of sins and the visual idea of whiter than snow. He's a dedicated Christian who lived in Washington, D.C., worked for the post office, and wrote this wonderful hymn that we just finished singing. And now see the pastor as he's bringing the offering forward.
Those who came to listen.
In our baptismal calling, we are bold to pray for those in need and all of creation. Our response today is hear our prayer. Servant of your people, help your church discover more and more joy in our work, prayer, and service to the world. Lead our faith community boldly into generous acts of caring for others. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator of earth and stars, awaken our wonder at the multitude of distant stars. Make us your hands to tend and stir the earth. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Proclaimer of truth and peace, use our voices to speak for justice. God, leaders of nations and communities to seek peace and reconciliation in the face of threats and violence. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Seeker of the lost, use our hands to serve those who are lonely, forgotten, hurting, angry, broken, grieving, or ill. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Protector of all, surround first responders with the comfort of your everlasting promise of love and mercy. Keep them safe from harm and grant courage in danger, calm in emergencies, and wisdom in unexpected situations. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Life of the living and the dead, you have renewed your covenant promises in every age, calling your saints at all times and places to serve your creation. Give us strength through their witness. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of earth and air, water and fire, height and depth, we pray for those who work in danger, who rush in to bring hope and help and comfort when others flee to safety, whose mission is to seek and save, serve and protect, and whose presence embodies the protection of the Good Shepherd. Give them caution and concern for one another, so that in safety they may do what must be done under your watchful eye. Support them in their courage and dedication, that they may continue to save lives, ease pain, and mend the torn fabric of lives and social order. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with I Love to Tell a Story, hymn number 661, in the back of your worship, hymn number 661.
This hymn was written by Catherine Hankey, 1866. It became the hymn of the YMCA. Catherine Hankey was an abolitionist from England who worked with William Wilberforce to eliminate slavery in England. Catherine Hankey, I love to tell the story. St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church was offering a Christian school program. We're looking for an administrator. We're going to start up again in January. Thank you for joining us in our worship service this Lord's Day. I'm Dr. Sally Abbott, your announcer, and Linda Fox is your videographer and assistant. We work together with this. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless and keep you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you. Continue to pray for us and our YouTube ministry. This is 9/11, September 11th, and we're honoring those who died 9/11, 15 years ago, September 11th. This is the 17th Sunday after Pentecost, September 11th, 2016. We're honored today to have flowers at the altar every Sunday. We've seen the altar and flowers today, and we're having a Yuletide Festival we're working on already. And going to be in November this year before Thanksgiving. We do thank those who have given today, participated in the service. Bill and Mary Nevius, ushers, and Diane Myers with the reading. St. John's Lutheran Church, we invite you to come any Sunday and worship with us. We provide the rainbow table for those shut-ins who have nothing to eat, those who are homeless. We invite you to come help us receive 8,000 meals a month. The wooden doors at St. John's Wittenberg Avenue in Columbia have now been finished. This restoration was done by Phoenix Construction. Take a moment to look at our new doors. They're in honor of Bob Widener, who died before they could be completed. So come and look at our new doors at St. John's Lutheran Church. We invite you to come anytime. Today's theme was God's mercy. He's had mercy on the prodigal son. He has mercy on those who are lost. We invite you to come worship any time with us. We invite you to participate with us. We have flowers on the altar. We're now having children's church every Sunday. We invite you to come bring your children. Gina Pollock is in charge of that. She's going to have arts and crafts. We invite you to come and worship with us. Another offering, things that you can do on Sunday. We have a gospel hymn every Sunday. We had quite a bit of snow today. It's a gospel hymn. We invite you to come every Sunday and worship with us at 8 o'clock in our sanctuary and 10:30. Our Sunday school is at 9:15.